All right, guys, welcome to the Tom Reefer Studio again. Here's the 20-gallon cube, mixed reef, the 3.5-gallon Pico, LPS dominant. Over here is the 6-gallon tall. It's official, guys, 6-gallon tall. And over here is the 10-gallon Peninsula, made from a $20 PetSmart tank. And this is where it all happens. I've been watching Elvis videos. So anyway, new viewers, this is Water Change Wednesday. What Water Change Wednesday is, you ask a question or a comment below the video, and I'll answer it there, and then I'll answer it here. We have some good questions today. Sand bed question. We have sand bed questions today, bubble algae, how to deal with that, welcome aboard the Tom Reefer train, alkalinity issues, how to stabilize it, do we coral dip our corals, and we got the old phosphate issues. So let's get into the video, Water Change Wednesday. Go. Sis Hamblin asks, I think I'm saying that right. So I'm dosing an all-in-one solution. It's like kalkwasser and it has magnesium in it. The calcium parameter is 450, but the alkalinity keeps fluctuating up and down. And he would like to try to do this without using two-part. My response to Sis Hamblin. Use easier names, guys. My response to Sis Hamblin is that's exactly the reason why I switched over to using two-part in my tank. Kalkwasser and one part alone don't necessarily stabilize your alkalinity. So I had told him it's possible if he does some water change. I asked him what his fluctuation was, and it was quite a bit. He said his fluctuation went from 8 dKH to 6 within 2 days. His concern is about precipitation in the tank if he tries two-part. Sea Balance has the directions right on the label. So you start minimal dose, and then you test. You go a few more weeks, and then you test again. So you increase as you go along, and then when you dial it in, you add that much, and you don't need a dosing pump. You can manually pour it in with a small container each time you're going to dose. Jibe47 asks about sand beds. He asked two questions, so we'll take them both together. He asked about bubble algae, and he asked about sand bed. Bubble algae, in my experience, is a real pain if it gets out of control, and I've tried I call them the muscle man crabs. They're the little emerald crabs. And they're okay, but if you have a serious situation, the only way I found is to go in there with tweezers and manually remove them. If you get them soon enough, early on, you can manually remove. The other thing about emerald crabs is they like to eat small fish. They're really strong. And they'll pick at some other corals, so different people have had different success with emerald crabs. I like to do things manually as much as I can unless I know it's a guarantee and it's not going to affect the corals and the inhabitants in the tank. He also asked about sand bed. He just put a 1-inch sand bed into his tank and he's noticing microorganisms and stuff in the sand bed, and he knows that I recommend vacuuming a sand bed to keep your phosphates down. So what I told him is, if it's initial stages, guys, let your sand bed go. Let it grow all the microorganisms and all that stuff in there. You don't need to do that right away. That's only if you start to see your phosphate rise to a number that you're not controlling it with a GFO, or like I've used lanthanum chloride. I like to use vacuuming the sand bed in an established tank as a first way to see if I can lower the phosphate. But in the beginning, let it go. Let it go for a few months, let things grow and see where your levels are and go from there. Thanks, Jai. This one's from Matt. He's new to the channel. Welcome aboard the Tom Reefer train, Matt. He asks, how do you determine how much of a sand bed you should use? And that's totally up to you. I always recommend no more than an inch, because what happens, you can go 2, you can go 3, but I have found in my 25 years of experience that over time they become nutrient sinks, especially for phosphate, and you'll wind up vacuuming them anyway. So what I've been doing lately is I'll do half with about a 1-inch sand bed and leave the other half bare bottom, or I'll just do a bare bottom like my 3.5 gallon Pico. So it's totally up to you, but I would recommend an inch at the most. The idea where deep sand beds came into play, guys, was years ago when I first started. They were thought to reduce nitrates. Those sand beds were meant to be 3 to 6 inches deep, and then it was said that they would denitrify your tank because of the depth and the low levels of oxygen down towards the bottom of the sand bed. Slowly but surely, you've seen a lot of reefers switch to bare bottoms, especially SPS, because they don't want to deal with phosphate at higher levels. So I would say 1 inch. This is a quick one. Coral dipping. Same guy, Matt. Matt, I don't really coral dip that often. I get my corals from a trusted source, Fish Guy Mike usually. There is a Coral RX. I believe it's by Brightwell. I'm not sure on that. But it's called Coral RX, and I've used that once when I had some SPS shipped in and I did a dip with them. Coral RX. This is a good question. Carson asked that he's surprised that I don't use some form of overflow protection in my overflow boxes. I'm a little lazy when it comes to that, Carson. I probably will. Once I see a snail climb over or a hermit crab down in there, I'll put some form of screen up there to protect them from going in there. All right, this is another phosphate question, but it's a little bit different. Brandon says he needs help with his phosphates. He says his corals are browning out, but his phosphate level is 0.1. My tank is 0.1, sometimes higher, and I have no issue with that, ever. His nitrates were between 5 and 10, and he said he was using the API test. And I told him I wasn't a huge fan of API. I used to have those years ago, and they just, the color rendition on them isn't real accurate. It's hard to determine exactly what your nitrate levels are or any of the levels when you use that test. So I recommend Salifert. His nitrate may be higher. If you get above 10, that's very possible that it's his nitrate that's causing his corals to brown. And that's just my educated guess. So Brandon had a lot of things going to try to reduce his phosphate. He had as much as you could do. He cut back on feeding. He was rinsing the food. He had C-Chem PhosGuard with a pad. He just had everything going on. I think we all make this mistake, is when something goes wrong with our tank, we start doing too many things all at once. So what I told him is to maybe try one thing at a time. We had another one. This I won't list a name, because 3 or 4 people asked what my skimmer was in the 5 gallon. And that's called Reef Glass, guys. It's a cool little skimmer. I would recommend it almost 30 and below. It makes a wet skimmate, but that's okay. Wet skimmate, removing more is better than not. I mean, you don't want it to remove too much, but a wet skimmate is okay. And then you can adjust it if you don't want so much skimmate, and it'll collect in the top of the skimmer. But that's called Reef Glass, and I believe it's like $80. It's not cheap, and you can get it at Premium Aquatics, and I believe Marine Depot or BRS, they carry it too. Reef glass. All right, guys, what do you think? I think that's enough for tonight, right? I agree. So have a great rest of the night. Thank you guys for subscribing. I'm almost at 2,000 new subscribers. I appreciate it. We're going to have fun here. Welcome aboard the Tom Reefer train. It's fun. It's educational. Just thanks. Everybody, thanks a lot. And just have a great rest of the night, and we'll see you Sunday. I don't know what I have planned for Sunday yet. We'll see. All right, take care now. Welcome to the studio, guys. How's it going?